Welcome! This is the last video on the macroeconomic flow. I've already explained the social economic perspective, which regards the economy as embedded, the institutional perspective, which focuses on institutions that mediate the relationships between economic agents, and the insights from Keynes, emphasizing the economy as an open system. In this video, I will explain the neoclassical macroeconomic perspective. Neoclassical economic theory regards the economy as a closed system. As such a system, there's equilibrium, and if not, the system will soon move towards a new equilibrium. Macroeconomic equilibrium not only means that AS equals AD, that is, aggregate supply equals aggregate demand, as in post-Keynesian economics, but also that in this point there will be no excess supply or excess demand in any market. In other words, all markets will clear. And they do so through prices. The general price level, the wage level, interest rates, the currency exchange rate. These are all prices. So, in neoclassical economics, prices always adjust to make markets clear. For example, in a financial market, interest rates will be at such a level to make the amount of investment equal to the amount of money that households save. And in the labor market, the wage rate will adjust in such a way that there will be no unemployment or vacancies left unfilled. In a diagram, it looks like this. An equilibrium at the intersection of aggregate supply and aggregate demand. Note that the diagram is in PQ space, which can be for any market. Q referring to the quantity of any good or resource, such as money or labor, and P referring to any price, such as the interest rate or the wage rate. Also note that in this space, AS has a positive slope and AD has a negative slope. Just like it was the case in microeconomics, in a market diagram for a normal good. More supply of apples with higher prices and more demand of apples with lower prices. Equilibrium is at the intersection of AS and AD, with equilibrium quantity Q star and market price P star. In a closed system, change occurs not from within, but from outside, through a shock to the system. For example, a drought could be a shock to the food market. In other words, in neoclassical economics, change is exogenous. A shock is followed by an immediate and final adjustment to a new equilibrium. Let's go through an example of exogenous change. Let's focus on the food market. And let's assume that the shock to the food market is a drought. This leads to a lower supply of food, and hence to an increase in food prices because food is now more scarce than before. As a consequence, the rich can still afford buying food. They spend more, and they may buy a bit less luxury goods instead. The poor buy less food. Some go hungry. The domestically produced food may become more expensive than imported food, so that the food market now also includes imported food. This increases the food supply again, so that the prices will go down again, towards a new equilibrium, and consumption expands a bit. The total effect on AS is a decline due to less food production. The total effect on AD is first a decline due to higher prices, and then some increase due to imports. This is shown in a diagram on the slide. The old AS and AD are the black lines. The food shock shifts AS to the back, because food production is less. The import shifts AD to the right, because demand goes up. The old equilibrium was P1, Y1. The new equilibrium is between the red lines, and that is P2, Y2. Note that there is less food sold and at higher prices than before, due to the external shock of a drought. As a consequence, we can conclude that the drought has caused inflation. The neoclassical macroeconomic perspective is summarized in the closed systems flow. You will see that nature functions as the ultimate resource which serves the economy. But it also can cause shocks through droughts and other disasters. And politics is a new area of influence, which is often regarded as a distortive factor through government policies. For example, politics may have led to food subsidies to fight hunger if there was a social democratic government, or to farmers successfully lobbying for higher import tax on food to prevent foreign sellers to get a foothold in the market if there was a farmer interest-oriented government. This was the last video on the macroeconomic flow. In the next series of videos, we will discuss the role of money in the economy. It's money that makes the world go around. So I guess it's high time we figure out how this exactly happens.